The children have been working on, they're walking through the Bible. They have mastered it, I think. So I think you guys are really going to enjoy it. They've worked really hard over the last probably 6 weeks practicing. So if everybody will just watch and enjoy, thank you so much.
Creation, Adam and Eve, sin, death, Cain and Abel, Eden, walked with God, flood, patriarch of sage, Abraham, father of the Jewish nation, Isaac, Jacob with Joseph, the coat of many colors, Jacob with Joseph, the coat of many colors. Second under Pharaoh, Exodus stage. Moses, let my people go. No. Ten plagues, go. Ten commandments broken.
Spy out the land, too scary.
40 years of wandering. The conquest stage, the promised land of Canaan. Hooray! Judges change. Every man did that which is right in his own eyes.
We want king! We want king!
United Kingdom. Saul, no heart. David, whole heart. Solomon, half a heart. Divided Kingdom. Israel in the north. Bad king. Judah in the south. A few good kings. Captivity stage. Dangling lines and roar. The fiery furnace. Return stage. Nehemiah built up the wall. Nehemiah built up the wall.
400 years of silence.
New Testament. Gospel stage. John the Baptist, Jesus, 12 disciples cross. Early church stage. Stoning of Stephen, gospel spread, Paul's missionary journeys. Epistle stage. Letters to the churches. Revelation.
Lessons learned. Plurals. Number one.
God always keeps his promises. His word can be trusted.
Boys, number two.
God has a master plan for his people, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and me.
Number three.
When I obey God, even if he doesn't make sense, I'll be blessed, I'll be satisfied, I'll be amazed when I see how he uses me.
Boys, number four.
God is always faithful. Oh, may I be like him.
Everyone, number five.
Jesus was God's plan to redeem us from our sins. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Oh, praise the name of Jesus.
Too far to turn back now. Getting ready to sing a song for week. They just learned recently. And this song literally just talks about really how good God's been. If God's been good to you, say amen. The title of the song is How Blessed. The words to the song talks about how blessed we are because literally as you look around, it describes things. It says in it, people that I've prayed for, asking for healing, seen somebody that I love, that they got some help, somebody that lost their way. You know, as I sit here and I look in this choir, y'all pay attention, listen. There were some of you that strayed. There were some of us that strayed. There were some of us that went down a path that we thought was a beaten path, and the truth be told, it had been walked many times, but it wasn't God walking that path, it was somebody else. But how many times have we seen God answer prayer? You look around this congregation, people that's been in and out of the will of God. You see people that's needed physical healing and marital healing and financial healing and spiritual healing. How many of you know that we serve the true healer? Amen? And this song, all it talks about is literally how blessed that I am. It gets to the second verse and it says, kneeling at an altar stained with tears, we have prayed for someone for so many years. Satan tries to discourage us from praying anymore, but then another answered prayer walks through the doors. Let me say this to you. I've not been saved a long time, but there's been times that my faith has got thin. And it seems like right when it gets thin, I look up and say, there goes brother so-and-so. There goes sister so-and-so. Or maybe you look over and you see somebody in the choir shouting and raising their hand. I remember what long ago I seen Brother James Edwards and Brother Jay Bennett. They were struggling about a year or so ago. If you notice, they kind of got out of the choir. There's some things. The devil's just beating them up. And then all of a sudden, man, God got a hold of their heart. Amen. And man, you see them up there and they look like they're going to punch somebody. You ever see somebody get so excited in the Holy Ghost? They're like, praise God. Amen. You know? But to me, I think how blessed I am. Amen. And church, let me say this to you. How blessed we are. To be able to see how God has done some things. And we forget that, hey, we're asking God to do something today, thinking, God, can you really do it? But look how many times He's already done it before. Right. This song is simply sung with a heart of gratitude. Amen. A heart of gratitude. Yes. And today as we look back, God's been faithful. You mind the Lord as they sing, all right?
Pray for love. was taught the scriptures before I could read them. I found them to be true. That's why I believe them.
I will follow Christ.
good for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain. Savior, if you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Chains, he's a chain breaker.
My thoughts and my feelings, when I can is there to claim? Some would give their very souls to reach earth's highest plane, but to count again would be my loss if I lay down commitment's cross. So I lift my eyes to things above and serve showed himself to me and said, just look what you can be. I just want to please the Lord, be in his will in every way, to be lost in his presence, found in his likeness, to hear him say,
like you've never been before. The life you knew in a thousand pieces on the floor. And words fall short in times like these, when this world drives you to your knees. You think you're never gonna get back to the you they used to be. Tell your heart over you. It's alright now. Love's healing hands have pulled you through. So get back up, take step one, leave the dark. I'm over and your journey's just begun. Tell your heart to beat again. Close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away. Step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door. You don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been and tell your heart to beat. Everything for your good. Tell your heart to beat again. Close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away. Step into the light of grace.
If you have your Bibles tonight, turn to James chapter 4, verse 14. And it's great to see Brother Jason, Brother Daniel, and Brother Pete. Remember the last time I saw some of these guys, we looked like we needed an ambulance walking out of Kerwin Baptist gym, played in a tournament together, and that was a whole lot of fun. I'm just thankful to be here tonight. I'm thankful, really to be here tonight. As you can see in that video, I've been through a lot, but, you know, it's all been through the help with the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm thankful for him and that he's my Lord and Savior. James 4:14 says, "Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and vanisheth away." Let that sink in. My story starts on June the 16th of 2015. I was playing at a high school like summer event with my high school at North Rowan, and we were playing at Catawba College right there in Salisbury. And we were playing a team out of Virginia, I think it was. And we were playing. I played the whole first half. Felt fine, just like I had done normally. Went in the second half and ran up and down a few times, still felt fine. And I remember catching the ball on the wing, like you saw at in that video. I caught the ball, pump faked, drove to the basket, went up with my right hand, and got fouled. And whenever I came down, I still felt fine and walked to the free throw line to shoot my free throws. And I looked over to our bench to see what defense we were going to be running on the following possession from my coach. And when I looked at him, I remember everything getting blurry, and I remember feeling lightheaded. So I started walking back over to our bench. And before I could get there, my mom was actually sitting under the basket, if this is kind of where the basket was. She was kind of sitting back here under the basket. And she said that I started just kind of reaching out for somewhere to sit down. And I actually laid myself out on the floor and collapsed and actually went into sudden cardiac arrest and was actually medically dead for 11 minutes. And by the grace of God and people praying, and I actually had people there that knew how to do CPR and use an AED, I'm here today. And over 400,000 people actually have out of hospital, sudden cardiac arrest like I had, and less than 10% actually survive. So it's just by the grace of God that I'm actually able to stand here and in the right mind being able to speak to y'all tonight. And I just want to thank the Lord for that. Whenever I was actually down, the whole time I actually thought I was in a dribbling competition, as crazy as that sounds. And whenever I first collapsed and went down, I remember the gym just kind of everything kind of getting really bright. And then it was just like I was back in the gym at Catawba. And in the tournament we were actually playing in, they had the bleachers pulled back on both sides. And there was three courts playing at the time. There was about 500 teenagers in there. It was a big, huge camp that they have every year. And whenever I went down, like I said, I saw the gym get like really bright. And then it was like I was back in the gym. But I remember hearing everything. It was really loud in the gym. And the bleachers had been pulled down on both sides. And whenever I actually got up, I guess you could say, looked around and everything was really loud. And I noticed I had two basketballs under my arms. And I was still kind of confused at the time because I was like, was I not just playing in a basketball game? And whenever I looked around, I saw my coach, actually, he's a Christian man. And he was actually standing right beside me to my left. And he was like cheering me on the whole time and giving me pointers about what to do. And beside him actually was my mom. And I looked around and noticed that if this was like the basketball court, I guess you could say, on this side, the bleachers were pulled down and they were all cheering for me and they were all dressed in like white kind of angelic outfits, I guess you could say. And I could hear them cheering for me saying, "You're going to win this. You got this. You can do it." And as I looked around, I looked to this side and I saw the people I was actually competing against. And they were all dressed in like black jerseys and black shorts, black shoes. And I noticed I had on a white jersey and white shorts and white shoes. And I looked around and on this side, everybody was dressed in like black clothes. And it was kind of like demonic feel. They were all taunting me and telling me I wasn't going to win and to just give up before it even started. And whenever I kind of realized kind of what was going on and realized I was going to be competing against other people, a guy walks out to mid-court, and he's kind of like a street ball announcer, if anybody like knows what that is. He was there. He was hyping up the crowd, telling everybody the rules and what was kind of going on. And whenever he did that, I remember being on the baseline. Like I said, I had the two balls under my arms. And at the back of Catawba's gym, they actually have a big scoreboard, and it was actually a traffic light. And I remember seeing it go red, yellow, green. And then we all just started dribbling, just like normal two-ball dribbling like you would do at a practice or a workout, working on your ball handling. We just all started doing that. And a few minutes passed, and I remember the guy on the far end who I was competing against, he actually quit dribbling. And whenever he quit dribbling, it was like the life just went out of him. And it was like I remember looking down there to see how everybody was doing and watching him quit dribbling. And he just like stood there and just fell back on his back. And whenever that happened, there was two doors kind of at the back of Catawba's gym. And I remember two guys that were dressed in like black, like Grim Reaper type outfits come in there and grab him up under his arms and drag him out the door. And whenever I saw that, at the time, I didn't know really what was going on. So I was like, oh my goodness, I'm definitely winning this event because I didn't know what was happening. And, you know, that's happened, you know, I've asked God, like, what does that mean? I've prayed about it. And, you know, he's kind of shown me that that's like our lost friends, our lost family members, that if they aren't saved, as much as we hate to say it, they're being dragged into hell. And it's up to us as Christian people to go talk to them before it's too late. And to take every opportunity that we have every day, either at the job, at school, as a teenager, wherever that may be, to just to take that opportunity to reach out to them and talk to them about Christ. And whenever I saw that, like I said, I was thinking to myself, oh, I'm definitely winning this now. And anyway, back, I guess you could say, in reality at this time, this was like probably 3 minutes in to the 11 minutes. And whenever I first went down, like I said, my mom saw it happen, and she ran out to the court because she felt it was more than a sprained ankle. I normally would have got mad at her if it was something other than that. But she ran out to the court and tried to roll me over and couldn't because it was kind of like dead weight. And one of my teammates helped her roll me over, and my eyes were rolled back in my head, she said, and my mouth was contorted to the side. And by the grace of God, there was actually an off-duty EMT that we had never met that had actually switched her work schedule that morning to come watch her son play at that camp. And it's just little things like that, how God set this whole situation up. You know, she wasn't supposed to be there, but by the grace of God, she actually was. And so anyway, she came out right behind my mom, and whenever she saw, like, my eyes were contorted and, like, my mouth and everything, she came over and assessed me, saw I didn't have a pulse or saw my heart wasn't beating, I wasn't breathing, and they immediately started doing CPR. And another thing is my grandma actually was there also, and she was a retired head of respiratory therapy at a hospital for 50 years. So she was doing the breaths and helped do compressions also, along with my other coaches who knew how to do CPR. So whenever that happened, like I said, they all came over, and the three courts that were playing at the time actually had stopped playing, and they were all gathered around in this huge circle just watching what was taking place. And one of my coaches, actually, he's a pastor of a church in Salisbury, and he was actually underneath my head the whole time just pleading the blood of Jesus over my life, that God would give me back my life and give me back my breath. And to the teenagers in here, or anybody really, if you're doubting, you know, does God really hear my prayers? He does. I promise you 100% that if there wasn't people in there pleading the blood over my life, I may not be here. And I'm just thankful for people that knew how to pray and get a hold of God. And so as everybody was gathered around, my mom was by my side, and she said it was so quiet in there, you could about hear a pin drop. And she actually got up and was like, "What are y'all doing? That's my baby. Y'all need to pray." And so the whole gym really erupted in like a old-fashioned prayer meeting kind of scene. And everybody was praying for me. And so anyway, back in the dribbling competition, I just saw the first guy quit dribbling. And a few more minutes had passed, and I noticed two or three others had quit, and the same thing happened to them. They were in the black jerseys, the black shorts, and they got drug out of the gym the same way. And whenever I noticed two or three of them quit dribbling, I remember the section that was dressed in the black clothes, they all were starting to get quieter and quieter, and it was because every time a person that was dressed in the black clothes would lose, a section of their crowd would leave. And so while I still had the crowd that was dressed in white fully cheering for me and saying, you got this, just keep dribbling, just keep dribbling. And my coach and my mom, they were getting quieter and quieter, and I became more encouraged, like, hey, I can do this. I might can do this. I'm going to win. And so a couple other guys quit dribbling. I think it was down to like one or two guys left. And I remember feeling really tired, and my arm started to like cramp up like right in here. And that's actually whenever the EMTs actually had gotten there, I think, or they got there pretty quick, and were actually putting IVs in my arms to get like fluid started. And I could actually feel my arms starting to like cramp up as they were putting the IVs in my arms. And so anyway, I end up winning and beating the two other guys that were left. And I remember looking around, and like I was still dribbling, and I was asking my coach, like, did I win? And he was like, oh, hang on, I'm not sure yet. So the guy that was the street ball announcer comes back out to midcourt, and he's like, hang on, you're not done yet. And I'm like, man, I'm exhausted. I can barely talk. I'm sweating. I need to go home. I'm tired. And he's like, well, we're going to see if you can set this world record or something like that for dribbling. And I was like, dude, I really don't want to set a world record. I'm tired. I'm done. I won. And he's like, well, just, and then I remember hearing my coach beside me. He says, come on, you got this. You want your name in the record books, don't you, or something like that. And I was like, okay, all right. So I took the challenge, and I was like, all right, well, I'll just keep dribbling for a few more minutes. So I'm still dribbling, and another minute or so passes by, and I'm like, coach, I got nothing left. I'm exhausted. And I remember him telling me, well, just sit down and dribble. You can do that. And I was like, all right, well, I'll try that. So I sit down, and I'm dribbling by my side. And a few seconds pass. I'm like, coach, I'm done. I don't have anything left. I'm done. And I remember laying down, him saying, well, just lay down and dribble. So I started laying down and started dribbling by my side. And whenever I did that, I remember seeing the crowd that was dressed in white just go, like, start going crazy and cheering and everything like that. And I remember going and taking this big, huge, like, deep breath. And that's actually when the AED shocked me, and I took my first breath. And the lady, Renata, that was actually doing the CPR, that was the off-duty EMT, she was like, we have a pulse, we have a pulse. And everybody that was surrounding me in the gym, like, started cheering and praising the Lord. I could hear everybody saying, hallelujah, amen, hallelujah, and clapping and, you know, just praising the Lord. And whenever that happened, they put me on the stretcher, and I had won the dribbling competition. And whenever they did that, they thought I was starting to go into a seizure, but I was actually going like this, like dribbling by my side. And I remember whenever they lifted me up on the stretcher, is whenever I actually remember opening my eyes and being aware of kind of what was going on. And at the time, I thought I had passed out doing a dribbling competition. So I was unaware that I had cardiac arrest and was dead for 11 minutes. And whenever Renata came to my side, she was like, you left us for a little while, baby, but we brought you back. And so I remember giving her a hug and saying, thank you. I'd pulled down my oxygen mask from the stretcher. And to give you an idea of like the hopelessness that was kind of in that gym at a point in time, I'd actually turned kind of like a navy blue gray color from lack of oxygen. And they actually took my mom out of the building because they thought they were going to pronounce me dead on the floor because I had been so long without any oxygen or a heartbeat or anything. And it just shows that with God, all things are possible. And I'm just thankful for that. And whenever I was on the stretcher, I remember my coach walking by too. And I remember grabbing his arm and him looking at me. And I was like, coach, was I not in a dribbling competition? And I remember the face he looked at me. He was like, what? And so that's just something funny that I remember from that. And to just show you, we actually went to the hospital, and within probably 30 or 45 minutes of having cardiac arrest, I was sitting up eating a Wendy's cheeseburger. And, you know, that just adds to how, you know, that had to have been God, because how many people do you know have cardiac arrest and within an hour are eating a Wendy's cheeseburger in the heart room? So I'm just thankful for it and thankful for what God's done. Back to this verse, James 4:14 says, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is like a vapor that appeareth for a little time and vanisheth away. And if I get across anything to the teenagers and everybody else in this building tonight, it's that you're not promised tomorrow. I woke up that morning just like any other morning, didn't think anything about it. And a lot of times as teenagers, we go through life, you know, we'll do something tomorrow. Oh, no, we'll just wait and do it tomorrow. We'll wait and do it the next day. We'll on a never-ending cycle. And it's just important to know that, you know, you're not promised the next day. And to just take every opportunity that you have that's given to you, you know, to serve the Lord. Actually, this event happened on a Tuesday on June the 16th. And the Sunday before that, I was at church and the pastor was preaching about being broken for God and letting him use your life. And I remember getting serious with God and going to the altar. And I said, you know, God, whatever it takes, I want you to give me a testimony to reach my friends and reach my lost family members. And on Tuesday, he answered that prayer. And a lot of people will look at that situation like, why would you ever, you know, want that to happen? That's terrible. It's a terrible thing to happen. Yes, it was, but it was in God's will, and that's what he had for my life. And honestly, I wouldn't trade it for anything that anybody could give me in the world, because I know that that's what God had for me in my life. And I'm just thankful for it. And I just challenge everybody tonight to just search your heart. And, you know, number one, know that you're saved. I wouldn't leave this room without knowing that you're saved 100%. And number two, I challenge you as a teenager or as a young adult to, you know, what is God's will for your life? Ask, and he'll let you know. And I just challenge you, because he's got a specific plan and task that he has for everyone in this building. And I just challenge you to ask God and figure out what he has for your life. And thank you, and just keep dribbling.
Mr. Everett's going to come, and we're going to give an invitation. And let me say this to you. He made a comment. He prayed on Sunday for God to do something. He said on Tuesday that God did it. The only problem was is the way he thought God was going to answer was a complete different way. There's a lot of things that I've got out of his testimony. But there's one thing that still sticks and rings with me since the first time I've ever heard him say it, and it's this. A lot of times we think God ain't answering because the answer seems to be so different than what we expected. But learn to accept the unexpected as the answer. God, I want you to use me. How many people has he been able to witness to? And let me say this. Why must we have that happen to us to be used of God? Y'all with me? Say amen. I mean, not only does he have a testimony, his mom and daddy's got a testimony. His sister's got a testimony. They've got testimonies because they've been through some things. So we look across this congregation. You remember as they sang the song, How Blessed. God, help my children, get them back to you, whatever it takes. And then we're thinking they're going to come to church, they're going to hear a good song, they're going to get to the altar, they're going to repent, they're going to confess it, they're going to go home, they're going to be right with God, and everything's going to be great. Hallelujah, that's the playbook. But God said, no, you asked me to get them right and get them back to me. Maybe they have to go through a dark valley to get there. Maybe they have to go through a dying situation. And I'm not just talking about physically. Maybe that person that you're praying about so much is dried up because you told the Lord God, whatever you need to do, get them back to you. And you're sitting there heartbroken, almost frustrated at God. But God says, isn't that what you asked me for? All last year, 2016, the Bassetts didn't run a race. Matter of fact, there was a number of races they didn't even get out there because they was praying, God, what is your will? The entire place gets burned down. God, we didn't ask for this. Since then, his son gets saved. And then as they cross victory line, him and a brother and a family and a pit crew
and all the fans are able to see what the devil meant for evil, God meant for good. The devil thought he had him. You know, let me say this. I was thinking about this. Kind of hard to believe you get a heavenly experience like that, ain't it? Yeah, whatever. All white, all black. This is all the good. This is all the negative. They're dressed out for glory and holy. They're dressed out for satanic. Must you die to believe it? Y'all with me? Say amen. So I wonder tonight how many of us, number one, would examine your salvation. Am I really saved? How old are you? 18? 18 years old. Heart solid. Physically solid. Life is but a vapor, he says. Here today and gone tomorrow. Are you living for God? Are you doing what you're supposed to do? Or maybe this evening, God reminded us that he does have an unorthodox way to answer prayer. That maybe, just like his family's probably done many a times, maybe we could get around the altar and say, Lord, thank you for answering, though I didn't know you was answering. Brother Jeff, isn't that what we talked about this morning? Same exact thing. Brother Jeff said he had to deal with something this weekend. He asked for God to help him. Said he left there kind of empty, and then God reminded him, well, isn't that what you asked me for? You love the Lord, say amen. Miss Jessica, how many times you pray for all those things? God had to do something through your husband. God had to take all those babies. But when God answers it, isn't it right on time? How blessed we are. Amen. I want you to stay. As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now, the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through him might be saved. That means that God sent his Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that he tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? When I ask you, would you trust in him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent his Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.